Just go ahead and start, Max, and people will start joining. Yeah, it's recorded, so we can upload it afterwards.
Very good. So very warm welcome to everyone joining our second webinar, Trans and Gender Diverse Representation at AIDS 2022. This session is about, informs the participants about various program points that are happening during IAS, during the conference, and also like a little bit more background information about the conference, and then also perspectives from community and activists that have been present in the past conferences to give a little bit of an insight about their experiences. And I'm very excited to welcome our guests. We have Ariane Brussemans, Director of Conferences from the International AIDS Society. Then we have Joanne Keatley from IRGT, and Navin O'Connor, Communications Officer from GATE, and Jennifer Sherwood, Public Policy Manager from AMFAR. Thank you so much for joining us. And what we've planned for today, we have little presentations from each of our speakers with a little bit with a specific field that they're going to present about the conference and kind of like what we're going to expect at the conference. And after that, we have a few questions prepared for the participants, and then we will open up the floor for a Q&A to all webinar participants in case you came with some questions for us. And I think we could directly dive in and start with Ariane, if that's all right, that you can go ahead and give us a little bit of an insight about where you are with like preparing and organizing the conference, maybe also what the current issues are, and let us know.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Max, and hello to everyone, wherever you are, all over the world. Obviously, we are very happy and excited to welcome you in 24 days exactly in Montreal or virtually on our platform. In terms of the organization, we are, well, all the bigger parts are ready. We have a fantastic program. Our logistics is all in place. We're working on the virtual platform at the moment, very much so. And obviously, there's a couple of issues that we don't always have any control of that we are also trying to solve, like the COVID situation, the monkeypox situation in Montreal, the immigration issues. So that's the main concerns that we're working on at the moment. But in terms of the exciting bits, I think we have at the moment a very, very large amount of people who actually want to meet again, because at the moment we have more than 9,500 participants that we're expecting. And out of those, we have around a bit more than 1,000 that we already decided they wouldn't join in Montreal, but they would join on the platform. This can, of course, change very much so in the coming weeks, depending on the visa situation and potential issues with flights as well. As you know, there is a worldwide crisis on flights and airline companies as well. So that's an additional issue that we are expecting that is out of our control. So if you are coming to Montreal, obviously do check your flight and your flight schedules, because there will be potentially quite some issues on that. But on the program side, so we have we have around 80 symposia that are planned. We have 30 oral abstract sessions, 200 poster exhibitors, and then a lot of more than 2,000 e-posters also that will be on the platform. And in the Global Village, we expect also more than 160 activities, whether they are sessions, film screenings, or performances. That will be very exciting. So on the highlights, so we have different highlights, obviously, and concerning your community, I'm very happy to say that we are actually having one of our guest speakers will be Admiral Rachel Levin, which is the she's Assistant Secretary in the White House. It's the first trans person in the US that is in the White House, so we're very happy that we will have her on the program. And then obviously we have Rina from Thailand, who will be also one of the high level speakers from your community. And just to note also that the program is now online. It's available on our website. So if you want to have a look at the various activities that we have, I'm not going to name them all because there's a lot of them, but there's also quite a lot of activities in the Global Village for your community as well.
Thank you so much, Ariane, for giving us a little bit of an insight of where we are right now. And we will come back to you in a little bit with a couple of questions that we have prepared for you. And next, we have Navin, Gates Communications Office, Gates Communications Manager, to talk us through some stuff that we at Gate are doing. And also, I just realized that I completely forgot to introduce myself, like the biggest mistake to do as a moderator, but it happens to me every time. So my name is Max Appenroth, and I'm the Research and Community Sexual Health Officer, also working with Gate, and I'm very happy to be here with you today. But the floor is yours, Navin. Thank you.
Thanks, Max. Yes, indeed, it's important to introduce yourself as well. Okay, so I am going to give an overview of some of the trans and gender diverse specific sessions or related sessions that are happening during the conference. So I'm just going to share my screen. Can you see that full screen now? Okay. All right. It's just a quick short presentation. The idea is to highlight sessions that are happening at the AIDS 2022 conference that are relevant to trans and gender diverse community. But these also are highlighting sessions that might be of interest to researchers who want to learn more about the HIV research focused on our communities. So Gate is currently compiling two calendars. One of them is includes sessions that are taking place within the AIDS 2022 conference itself. And then the second calendar is a calendar of events that it's taking place within the Global Village in the Trans Networking Zone, which this year is called Transport, a Trans and Gender Diverse Community Re-engagement Hub. So the aim of these two calendars is to highlight the sessions that are relevant to our community and also to shine a spotlight on trans and gender diverse professionals, so academics, researchers, and activists who are going to be presenting or moderating at the conference. Now, in order to compile the calendars, we had to have some criteria for inclusion. So we used the keywords searching through the AIDS 2022 online program. We use trans, transgender, and gender diverse in the various spelling variants of that to get a full overview of what is relating to our communities. And then we also did a second search where we focused on presenters and moderators and professionals, basically, who are presenting at the conference who identify as trans or gender diverse. Just a note on the criteria for inclusion. With the keywords, we didn't look at the language that was used and include or exclude based on that. We simply just said, if these keywords are included, they're going to be included on our calendar. With the second criteria, it's important to note that some of these sessions aren't specifically presenting on issues relating to trans and gender diverse communities, but it's more to highlight the fact that trans and gender diverse professionals have interests just as diverse as any other research professional, and to just highlight that. So just to provide an overview then of some brief highlights that so far we've got included in it, in the calendar from the AIDS 2022 conference itself. There's a session on integrated trans competent care. There's a session on centering trans and gender diverse communities in sustainable HIV financing. There is a Gates satellite session, which we had to include, of course, on the meaningful trans inclusion in HIV national strategic plans. And Jennifer will be talking a little bit more about that. Though our sessions around community-led responses and research, there's a sensitization workshop focused on healthcare professionals on trans health needs and rights. And there's also a session on the interaction between hormones and antiretroviral therapy within trans communities. So this is just an overview of just some of the highlights. There's many more sessions that are included in the calendar, but I just wanted to provide just a brief overview. And then in the trans networking zone, of course, this is a zone that's run by a group of trans-led organizations. So all the sessions in it are led by our community for our communities. So there will be daily social meetups. There are sessions on COVID-19 and trans populations. There's a session on the situation in Ukraine as it's affecting queer people. There's a presentation of two different toolkits. One is on HIV prevention services for trans women of color, and another one is on assessing the continuum of services in trans populations. There are several sessions around funding the HIV response as it relates to trans and gender diverse communities. And then there is also a session that's on intersex people and sexual rights, which is going to be presented by Gates' new intersex officer. So not specifically relating to trans communities, but it is a massively overlooked issue in relation to the HIV response. So we have that included in the trans networking zone. Unfortunately, just to mention that the sessions that are happening in the Global Village are only going to be accessible to people who are attending in person. Gate will be doing some coverage of those sessions. We'll be live streaming a few things and doing some interviews and stuff. And we will be having a post-conference overview of all these sessions that are from both calendars. But that's just important to mention that if people are joining virtually, unfortunately, they won't be able to engage in these specific sessions. So how can you subscribe to these calendars? So a week before the conference starts, we will have these calendars uploaded onto our website. You can find them if you go to gate.ngo/AIDS-2022. And you'll just be a link which you can just subscribe to both calendars. And they're just like a Google calendar. So just a regular subscribe to calendar thing. So those will be up a week beforehand. So that's it from me. And I'll just I'll stop sharing my screen now and hand it back to you, Max.
Thank you so much, Navin. I mean, you can see that there is a lot of stuff happening during the conference that is targeted or inclusive of trans and gender diverse people. And I'm very excited. There's a few sessions that I already marked in my calendar that I want to attend. And you've also heard that we are planning, or not we're planning, like we're going to have a session together with AMFAR on inclusion of trans people in national strategic plans. And I would like to ask Jennifer to tell us a little bit more about that.
Great, thanks. Hi all, I'm Jennifer from AMFAR, based in Washington, DC. And thrilled today to talk a little bit about the session that we'll be co-hosting with Gate. The overview from Naam was great. I think we are excited to highlight some results from some work that we've done together over the past year. This work was funded by the Elton John AIDS Foundation and was, the major goal was to increase trans inclusion in national strategic planning around the country or around the world. But we are focusing our work in five specific areas. This was a big goal, and we are of course still in progress, but we have made some incredible strides. And the satellite, which is very early morning on Friday, the first morning of the conference, 7:45 a.m. So it is early. Myself being not a morning person, understand the hassle of getting there early, but I really think that this one will be worth it. And we'll focus on a few bodies of work. What we're going to do is first overview a systematic review that AMFAR and Gate led to look at what the current state of trans inclusion is across national strategic plans in 60 different countries. This was done in collaboration with some local partners, talking about what meaningful inclusion looks like. We'll break it down by region and look for where there's big opportunities to increase trans inclusion and what that can mean. And then we're going to turn it over to some local partners who are flying in, who will be there in person to discuss the work that they've done over the past year. Partners from Kenya, Uganda, and Zambia will be there, from Jinasu Kenya, East Africa Trans Health and Advocacy Network in Uganda, and Transbatu in Zambia. And these orgs have really been leading the work over the past year. Many of them have been doing this work for a really long time, and so we'll have deep perspectives of the country context and how the work has been progressing. But we'll highlight specifically over the last year the extra activities that were added to their plate with this additional funding. And I am personally really excited to hear how the country work has progressed. I've had a few conversations with these organizations over the past few months and have heard about some of the incredible trainings, engagements with government, police in some cases, certainly with communities throughout the nations that they're really galvanizing behind some major asks and demands for increasing inclusion in government documents. So just really looking forward to that. And lastly, I'll say that that we expect and do hope that there'll be government and national and multilateral partners in the audience from both Global Fund and from UNAIDS. And so we really do anticipate this is a good opportunity to speak with policymakers, to present these results to those who are working closely with NSPs or national strategic plans globally. That's the basic overview, but there'll be lots more detail there, and we really hope to see you there.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. I mean, like, everyone heard how early it is, but you also heard how interesting the content of our satellite session is, so you better be there.
There'll be coffee. Yeah, it'll be great.
No, I mean, I'm very much excited, and also like to have the local like community or like the partner organizations present at the conference is really important to also hear the voices of the people we work with over the past few months. And to go on with our program for today, I would like to ask Joanne to tell us a little bit more about the Global Village, or like more basically about the trans networking zone, and like the experiences that we've had in the past years, and like how this space can actually be used for trans activists, but also maybe for allies to take something away.
Great, thank you, Max. I might add, I hope that early morning satellite session, I hope that's one of the sessions that's going to be accessible virtually, because I think it will be difficult for people to get there in person at that hour, but I'm really excited about it. I think it's a satellite session that's going to be very useful. And so I'm hoping that you do make it accessible virtually as well. So thanks for having me, Max, and great to be here with all of the panelists. I'm very excited to come together in Montreal. I think that it's been long overdue. It's been a couple of years now since we've been able to come together as a community to really discuss the global issues, the global impact of HIV and COVID on our community worldwide. And so I really place a lot of importance on both the larger conference and on the networking zone itself within the Global Village. As the name implies, it is a global village, and it's an opportunity for us to come together with colleagues from all over the globe who otherwise would not have opportunities to interact with each other and exchange ideas and share successes and frustrations and barriers and ways to overcome those barriers. And so I think that is what I look forward to in the Global Village, is really an opportunity for us to, to be able to build some synergy around the work that we all are all engaged in. I can share with you that the networking zones for trans people, we actually don't have that long of a history of having existed. IRGT, partnered with GATE and with other organizations back in 2004 for the very first trans networking zone when we pulled that together in Melbourne, Australia. And that first networking zone, we were all of the activists that were involved in pulling that networking zone together. We were just kind of fed up that there were these global spaces within the global village that had different community set aside spaces for networking, and trans people were always being kind of relegated to someone else's networking zone. So, we either had an opportunity to kind of, have a carve out within an MSM booth, or a carve out within a sex working booth, or a carve out somewhere else, LGBT group even. But never had there been in the history of the International AIDS Society meeting a networking specific zone for trans and non-binary people. And so in 2004, like I said, partnering with our regional and global partners, we pulled together the first networking zone. Then in 2006, we kept up the tradition, and we started doing, in addition to the networking zones, we started really working on pulling together other activities at the International AIDS conferences. And so that's the short history of networking zones. GATE and IRGT together have been involved in this work, and other regional partners, such as Red Trans Peru. We've partnered with SHE from South Africa. We've partnered with Clinic Q, with Transgender Europe, and many others. There's too many to share with you today. But it's been really an incredible honor to come together as civil society partners, and to be able to bring this resource together for the community to engage and to network with one another. I think that also what we look forward to is that it also affords our allies and the funders that we work with, the regional, national, and global research bodies that interact with us, and also some of the large government agencies that support our work, to have an opportunity to come and meet with us, visit with us, hear directly from our voices, not through a screen, but through in-person meetings, which can really be revealing for those of us that, or for those colleagues that we don't work with on a daily basis. And so it gives them a different perspective of who we are and the broad area of issues that impact us. And also the strengths that we bring to the table, because I think that sometimes, when we are in crisis mode or responding to, crises in our community, then, we come from a position of asking for assistance. And sometimes we actually bring skills to the table that we can offer and strength. So all of that takes place in the networking zone. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so excited that we're doing it again this year. I think you all know that in 2000, we were, or in 2020, sorry, not 2000, but 2020, we were about to host a networking zone in San Francisco, again, with Gate and our regional partners. And of course, it had to be shut down because of COVID. And so that was really challenging to put together, you know, a global village networking zone virtually. We did it, but and we learned a lot of lessons. We learned primarily the lesson of, you know, how well this works in person and the challenges that are associated with doing it virtually. So anyway, I look forward to working with you further on in Montreal, and I'm excited to see you all there, and I'll turn it back over to Max. Thanks for having me so early this morning, and I'll see you in Montreal.
Thank you so much, Joanne. Thank you so much for sharing also like your experiences from past conferences. And I mean, I think it's for us as a community, it's really important to have, again, a space where we can come together. But I have a couple of questions that I brought for our speakers. And I actually would like to go back to Ariane first to actually give us a little bit, not like, again, some background information, for example, on scholarships. Like, is there, like, how does it look like this year with scholarships in terms of like the rate? Has there something changed and like compared to past conferences? Or do you also see like current challenges regarding the scholarships and the attendees who receive the scholarship?
Thank you, Max. Yes, that's actually one of the most challenging projects for AIDSIS was the scholarships. As you know, traditionally, mm-hmm. we were supporting people to go to the conference. And as Joanne mentioned very rightfully, we all learned in the last 2 years, 3 years, that networking, unfortunately, is not the same online. So yes, for the scholarship, what we did this year is that we wanted to offer both registration access for people virtually, and also obviously the whole travel and registration to the people wanting to go to Montreal. But the problem is that it was highly unpredictable in terms of, first, all the COVID situation, which wasn't really clear until April, and secondly, because now the immigration issues proving to be more challenging than we have expected. But what I can tell you is that at the moment, I mean, we had the largest pool of scholarships ever. We had 11,000 applications this year. And out of those, we had budget for 1,600 people to attend the conference. So you can imagine it was very challenging for, well, the selection. So again, apologies to the whole community for those who didn't get a scholarship. But I would say, like, keep trying for, you know, in the next years, we will be able to allocate scholarships to you. But yeah, at the moment, it looks like we have allocated around 600 scholarships in that will travel, and the rest will be online. But people are still switching at the moment because of the visa situation, so they can still switch to a virtual participation. But that's where we stand at the moment. So I know it's not very precise, but we will only have the precise numbers after the conference. Sorry, I mentioned it's 713 to be exact virtual scholarships, and 890 in person. So it was actually the opposite. We have more in-person scholarships that we provided. But again, this can still change.
Thank you so much for sharing this information with us. I mean, it's great to see that there's effort being like taken into like trying to get communities there, and obviously like the demand is often higher than what is actually being able to be provided. So I mean, speaking of the scholarships and actually getting people to the conference and like making sure that people can engage with one another. So maybe the question would be like to Navin, like what are the opportunities for trans people to come together and support each other during the conference? You know, like what can be done from a community perspective to get together with each other?
Yeah, thanks, Max. And I'm sure Joanne could elaborate on this, but the networking zone for trans people in the Global Village is the perfect space for trans community to come together. It will be open not for the full duration of the conference, but from Saturday the 30th to Monday the 1st. Our networking zone will be open from 10:30 in the morning until 6 p.m. And we have a whole program of activities, but there will also be daily meetup sessions. And it's just a general space as well for people who want to meet other trans and gender diverse non-binary participants at the conference. And to plan attending specific events or any kind of activism orientation activities that they want to do as well. And I know as well, I just want to kind of mention this specifically because I know Joanne is involved with this, that there are some focus groups sessions that are going to be happening which allow the transgender diverse community to come together and to express what they think their priorities are. I'm maybe just hand you back over to Joanne if she wants to just elaborate a little bit on that, because I know it's in two languages.
Great, thank you for bringing that up. I should have brought it up earlier, but you know, it's early. I also want to correct something that I said earlier. I said that you know, the history of the networking zones were not that far, and then I said I misspoke and I said 2004, when actually the first networking zone took place in 2014 in Melbourne. And so I just wanted to, you know, correct that on the record. But the focus groups that we will have in the networking zone are really critical. I think, as I mentioned earlier, we didn't really have an opportunity to come together as a community since the last International AIDS conference in Amsterdam. And so there's been lots of, you know, impacts on the community, both from HIV, but also in terms of human rights and in terms of COVID. And so we are going to utilize the time and space that we have in the networking zone to give an opportunity for the community to speak and to share their concerns, their, you know, their priorities. They won't be long sessions. So, you know, we will have a kind of guided discussion, but we will document all of the input that the community provides. And they will be in English for one session, and then we'll have a Spanish speaking session as well on I think the second day. They'll be at different times of the day as well, so that and people can you know, attend even if they don't speak English. If they don't speak Spanish, they can still attend, and you know, we'll make sure to be able to capture you know, what people have to say one way or another. So and then our plans are to gather the information and not just sit on it, but obviously use it to really inform our partners in the field who can then use that information to better plan for providing services for our community. Resources, services, focus, all of that. So we feel that in order to really better serve trans community, you have to speak directly to trans people and get the information directly from them about what are the issues that are impacting our lives on a daily basis. Whether it's COVID, whether it's, you know, the lack of access to employment or you know, violence, you know, or HIV or any of the other things that, you know, impact our lives on a daily basis. Thanks for bringing that back up.
Thank you, Joanne, for adding this information. I mean, it's not only for community to learn for the field, but it's also specifically also for our allies, for our cis allies to learn from trans people and to learn like what, or like to hear what we have to say. And I mean, that would be a question that I would like to jump to Jennifer, because like we work together as a trans organization with an organization that is inclusive of trans people, but not only focused on trans people. So what do you think are like is the importance of collaborations, like the joint satellite session that we're doing at AIDS 2022? And what can we achieve with such collaborations during the conference?
Thanks. Yeah, I think, you know, for me, it's been the collaborations, I think it's not only beneficial, but it's just vital. With our project that we worked on together, one thing that I was struck by was sort of the diversity of expertise that are brought to the table when you bring diverse groups to the table. So, you know, we have just between the collaborative organizations, we have deep knowledge in methods and in science and in publication, and can sort of bring that to the table in conjunction with strong communications. You know, GATE brings such global reach and brings together partners from all over. And such deep expertise in the space that I think it can't be understated how important it is to match those expertise and put them together. And then anytime you bring more people to the table, you're really able to get your message out to different networks and reach different spaces that you normally wouldn't be able to do. You know, I think each organization has contacts in different realms, be it policymakers, be it national governments, be it local communities. And so anytime you bring global orgs and local orgs together who are able to tackle issues at grassroots level, and then also use global orgs as a mouthpiece to elevate that message and spread it to policymakers and to other contexts that we've spent years developing, I think you see the benefits exponentially comparatively to if one party tried to do it, to try to go it alone. So, you know, I think that the in a conference space like IAS, you know, I think this year will be the first time that many of us who have been working together online for so long will ever meet in person. And the benefit of FaceTime, I think, is can't be understated. The benefit of side conversations and the ability to live discuss things and debate things, I think is something that, you know, we have done our best as a community to mimic in the virtual space over the last couple of years. But I think that this will be an important opportunity to have people in the same room who care about the same things to really progress issues forward. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, thank you so much. I mean, this is really like, I just noticed it, like I was at an event the other day, which was the first one also for this organization to come together. And like all the, as you mentioned, the side conversations that are happening, not only like, you know, during the sessions and everyone's dropping off once the meeting is done and you just click leave meeting and, you know, it's over, like everything that follows these like conversations or sessions is really, really powerful and also needed. And I hope that we can engage as much as possible. So we have a question in the chat, and I think it kind of like fits the conversation that we're having, because Sean asked, what are the trans organizations or co-organizers? And I would maybe also direct it to like the conference organization in itself, hoping to get out of AIDS 2022, and what would you want a conference participant to leave with, any like type of key message? I would just like leave this open to anyone. I mean, we can also direct it, you know, or like maybe rephrase it in a way, direct it to IAS in a way of like, what are you hoping with a broad inclusion of communities at the conference? What to achieve with this?
If I can maybe jump in there on the overall broad theme of the conference, which is re-engage and follow the science, I think it summarizes very much what we're trying to achieve and what we already said about meeting again all in person and re-engaging in the HIV response, re-engaging all mm-hmm. actors, all parties in the HIV response, and also follow the science. So that linking what Jennifer said is how can we progress our issues with scientific evidence? That's the main goal of the conference.
I think for trans, may I speak up, Max? Do you mind? I think speaking for my little world and my little piece of the trans world. I think one of the things that we'd like to see is actually the opportunity to kind of influence the type of research that is being conducted and, you know, considered for trans people all over the world, but, you know, trans people who are being disproportionately impacted by HIV and AIDS and disproportionately impacted by other epidemics such as COVID. And so what I'd like to see is really the re-engagement of the scientists with community-led research so that, community is informing their practice and their research priorities. I think sometimes researchers come up with ideas on their own or with other researchers, and sometimes community is not at the table. And so I think that's one of the things that I really appreciate about the International AIDS Conferences is that it's really almost a unique space where we can come together and really have, you know, voices afforded our community so that we can help guide future research. And, you know, really talk about re-engagement in a way that is meaningful and inclusive for our community. And I think that it leads to better research outcomes when we're at the table and really helping researchers think this, you know, through clearly. So that's one of the, you know, my main goals. I think the other main goal is to like really bring back I live in the U.S. and so, you know, we've been in a very cohesive environment in this country. There's been lots of, division. And I think that, you know, the whole world is experiencing, different kind of versions of that discohesion. And including, you know, I think in trans communities, there's been a lot of distance between us because we haven't been able to come together because of the pandemic and its impact on our regional work. And so what I'd like to see is really, for the community to come back together and to like really build strength through our synergistic, you know, process to come together and really, kind of come up with a set of mutual goals that we can all work towards and adhere to. And so that's the other thing that I'd really love to see is, have an opportunity to put that global lens on and, you know, try to figure out what is going to impact the world in terms of trans and non-binary populations. So, yeah. Big goals, by the way. But
well, I mean, let's aim big and high. And I mean, The sky is the limit in that sense. I mean, there's still so much work we need to do. But I'm also very.
You don't dream, you know, it doesn't happen.
Exactly. Do you, Jennifer or Navin, do you have any other any goal or something that you wish for the work that we're doing at the conference, like any type of like takeaway message or key message that you would like to transport to participants, or even participants walking away with that message and spreading it somewhere else. I mean, that would be be amazing. Please, Jennifer. Yeah.
Yeah, either. Yeah. I think a great question. And hard to say, hard to summarize briefly, but I love what Joanne said about the ability for different types of people to talk to different types of people. I think that we, being a researcher myself, it's, you're often siloed. You're talking to other researchers and if you miss the critical step of designing your project with community, then you've already limited your dissemination opportunities. And so if you don't engage with people until the end of your study, your results only reach certain ears. They only get so far, and it's a miss. So I think a benefit, and I think, personally for me, being in a space where people are talking about their priorities, they're talking about their barriers, research questions arise from those spaces naturally because, everyone is discussing what they want for the future, what they see as big issues currently in their work. And I think that those blending of spaces is something that a conference can do that doesn't always happen naturally out in the world. I think that having policymakers and other sort of champions of the work or people who could be champions of the work are available. And it's a great opportunity for activists to get face time to, I love the sort of the history of IIS to the ones I've been to where activists use the space to reclaim time, to show up on stage, to really put messages forward that don't always get the spotlight. So I think that it's another opportunity, and what I hope to get out of it too is to build champions. I think in addition to engaging with sort of usual suspects who you're already speaking to, who you already agree fully with you. So I think that those are two big goals. And for anyone attending the satellite session specifically, I do hope that we can engage with more country level folks who might benefit from some of the work that we've spent time developing over the past year. GATE has led the development of best practice guides for some really key and practical ways to help and treat trans inclusion in your country, in your national processes. And so I think just specifically, it would be great if we could use this session to dig deeper in the countries where we're already engaged, and then also spread to countries that we haven't yet had local conversations with, would be a goal.
Yeah, I'll just, just from GATE's perspective, I think, everyone's touched on all the really key points, my only addition to it would be that, obviously it's both a virtual and in-person conference, and, it's going to be amazing to see people in person, but it's also, not to discourage people who are going to be attending virtually. There are still a huge number of opportunities to learn and to engage. And certainly, we'll be engaging on social media, there will be opportunities to input into different sessions, virtually as well as in person. So, just to because obviously for some people it's just not physically possible to come, right? And just to reiterate the point that it is a hybrid conference, and that we will be doing our best to try to ensure that people are engaging in both in person and virtually. And to maybe just put that as a reminder as well, to everybody, who's attending, that opportunity is still there. And and that there is something just amazing about people coming together. It reinvigorates, I think, research. It reinvigorates people's enthusiasm for what we're all doing, you know, and that can't be understated. So yeah, that's all I wanted to add.
Thank you so much. I mean, there is, as we said before, you know, sky's the limit. There's so much we can do, and there's so many opportunities that we can actually have as a as a community to make ourselves being heard and to also maybe reach people that we haven't reached so far. Let it be community that might actually engage for the first time with a group of trans people, but also at the same time reaching people who might be interested in working with us and trying to, you know, learn from our community and what our needs are. And I mean, I can only encourage you again to, for the ones who might have joined a little bit later, Naaman already shared that we will, as Gate, we will set up a calendar, and maybe Naaman, maybe you can post the link in the chat again for those who might have joined later, that we have a calendar that we will share all the information about the trans specific or trans and gender diverse inclusive program points from the conference program, but also specifically what happens in the Global Village. And maybe also to those who do not know, the Global Village is free. Like, you do not have to have access to the conference. You don't need to have need to pay the conference fee to access the Global Village, which is also like very important, specifically to local trans people in Montreal. If you know some, please tell them, or even people who might be interested. And that would be something that I would encourage people to come and join us and to listen to what community has to say, but also to enjoy and engage in the social activities that we're planning. And there's one last, there's one last question that just came into the chat, which I think we could address for a moment, because we know, and maybe this is like the last question, Ariane, someone asked about the visa processes, and we've talked about it like before we entered the webinar. Maybe there's something you can give as an update. What's the current situation there?
Yeah, so on the visa, it is a very complicated situation, not only for AIDS 2022, but for many other conferences all over the world. There's a huge delay in visa application in some countries more than others. We've been putting a lot of pressure, as well as other community groups as well, on the Canadian government to really process the visa applications of AIDS on a fast track. Which is what we had put in place. But I have every week meetings with the immigration services where they update me about the status, but there are still a lot of visa applications that are pending. So we really hope that those will be processed. Now, for all the people who have not sent in their visa application, unfortunately, I don't think there will be a possibility to attend in person at this point in time. For those who had put their visa application in time, there's still hope, and you don't have to lose your hope, because we're really putting a lot of pressure and we see the situation evolve. I just received a message, as a matter of fact, in the webinar that they're actually really processing, and some of the difficult consulates and embassies in the different parts of the world. So rest assured, we're doing our best. If you're a registered delegate, you are on our list that we're sending through immigration, and you are on the fast track application process. But that's unfortunately so much we can do, because in the end, the decision whether to accept or not remains in the hands of the immigration persons in the different countries.
Thank you so much for sharing this information. And I mean, let's hope for the best that we can actually re-engage as like the conference model in a way that, you know, that we can come together and that it's possible for people to travel. And let's just cross all our fingers to make this possible.
Thank you.
And thank you so much to all of our speakers. Thank you, Ariane. Thank you, Navin. Thank you, Joanne. And thank you, Jennifer, for joining us today. And I see that there's a lot of motivation, like especially within me. I'm also like, I'm ready to come to Montreal and hope to see as many people as possible from different parts of the world and friends that I haven't seen in a while, but also to do the work that we're doing, activism around trans and gender diverse issues. And I'm very grateful to have allies on board that will help us to amplify our voices. And yeah, thank you so much for joining us today, and also to the participants of the webinar. Thank you for joining us, and I hope to see you soon.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.